Buenos dias. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing? Good. Well, on behalf of MCLR and our Institute for Hispanic Health, I want to welcome you all to this year's annual health summit presented by Lilly, and just let you all know that we're so thrilled that you all can be here and you can have these really great discussions around Latino health with us. We have quite a breadth of topics to talk about this year, and we're really excited to have you all here. I'm going to go ahead and give you some brief logistical information, and then I'm going to go ahead and let some folks make opening remarks. So first of all, just so you all know, bathrooms are just on the right as you exit the room, as will be the sessions for the rest of today, just around the corner and to the right. And we will be having some events today in conjunction with our annual conference, the Tuesday luncheon, the Health Town Hall, which is back in this room this afternoon, the President's Reception, and the gala. Now we have, as I mentioned, quite a lot to talk about, and unfortunately not all the time we would like, so I'm going to ask you to please keep, as we make these transitions into our next sessions, to please keep an eye out for my colleague Elizabeth, who is taking your tickets. She's going to be giving you a slight warning that sounds like this, so you all know to go ahead and go to the next room so that we can go ahead and start promptly. Last two reminders, and then I can go ahead and let us all start, is that we are encouraging mobile applications this year of our individual sessions. So if you've downloaded the MCLR application on your phone and you go ahead and open it up, there's a Health Summit, there's a little square with Health Summit on it, and if you tap on it, you'll be able to evaluate every session individually. It's 5 questions, so it's short and sweet, and so we're going to try and encourage that this year so we can get even more of your feedback. Lastly, as a big reminder, that all of today's sessions will be held here at the LA Convention Center, but tomorrow all sessions will be held at the JW Marriott. And I will be reminding you a couple times of this, but I just want to go ahead and let you know now. And now I can go ahead and introduce our Senior Vice President of Programs, Delia Pompa, who's going to make a few remarks. Thank you.
Good morning. How are you? You look bright and cheery and ready to go. Marcela Vargas was too modest about her role. Marcela has been pulling this summit together for the last several months, and I hope you'll have the opportunity to talk with her during the summit, she along with the other staff who you'll meet later. Well, I want to welcome you. This is our third annual summit, and we're very excited about this. When we began discussing this summit 3 years ago, we thought, well, do we think people are that interested? Do we think we can get them to a health summit and also the conference? And you proved that we could and that you wanted more, and you've been writing to us and calling us, and we really, really appreciate that. We're excited about the possibilities. We're excited about the way you've pulled together to do a lot of important work that's been going on these last 3 years. And we do think the summit has contributed greatly to that work, whether it's the Affordable Care Act, the fact that we're highlighting mental health. Many, many of these events, occurrences, have been because of your input at this summit. I would be not only remiss, but I would be, I would go back, and I don't know what I would do for penance if I did not thank Lilly Corporation for the support that they've given us. And you're going to hear from them in a while. They are our presenting sponsor. Rafael Robert had the gleam in his eye to get this started, and I hope you'll talk to him during the summit also. And they have been our presenting sponsor for 3 years. This year they are joined by Pfizer, and we're so excited to have you. Where are the Pfizer folks? Not here yet. We're so grateful for their sponsorship and support. These sponsors make it possible to bring you here and make it possible to bring our speakers in, and we are eternally grateful to them. There's some folks, I don't know if you noticed, who walked in a big group a while ago. Those are Comprando Rico y Sano peer exchange participants. They have been working hard. And we'll be working very hard over the next couple of days. Thank you all very much for being here and for your and for your hard work that you're doing in the field. They're signing up people for SNAP programs. They're doing education around SNAP, teaching people about healthy shopping, and it's another one of our health projects that we're very proud of. There's another group of people that deserves not only thanks, but some other way to pay them back. I'll have to think about that. And that is our Health Summit Committee. Would you stand, members of the committee? There's one there, another one here, another one here. Thank you very, very much. They've been meeting for about 6 months, I guess, planning, thinking about what kinds of presenters we should have, what formats should be like, giving us invaluable input into shaping this conference, and we're very, very grateful for your participation. So finally, I did mention how indebted we are to Lilly, but I'd like to give them an opportunity to talk about their engagement here and why this is important to them. And I'm gonna turn it over to Monique Hunter-McWilliams, who is the Chief Diversity Officer at Lilly, to provide some remarks for you. I'm looking forward to seeing you over the next couple of days, and enjoy and learn a lot. Thank you.
Good morning, and I also want to welcome you and thank you for your participation today. You know, Lilly has been a longtime partner of NCLR, and I'm very proud to say that we have been part of the very creation of this Health Summit, now in its third year. And as a part of that partnership, our vision has always been one about empowerment and partnering to help us better serve the people in the communities where we serve. Because we know we can't do it alone. And so that's why we so much appreciate the partnership that we have with NCLR. Now is the time, this is the moment, to address healthcare issues in this community. It has never been more evident to me than in my participation in the Health and Family Expo this week. My team provided health and wellness information to everyone who came by our booth. And the people who came by our booth were most interested in helping themselves and their families to lead a better life. They were interested in information about how to make better food choices, about how to prevent or control high blood pressure, about how to maintain a healthy body weight so that they could prevent or control chronic conditions. I met people who were suffering with chronic conditions, but many people were overwhelmed or confused with our current health system. I am proud to say that I also met people who want to help. People like all of you who are in this room today, who care and who are equipped or want to be equipped to provide answers to the questions that your community seeks. And so with that in mind, I want to say that I hope you will use the time today to take all the great information that you receive and all the great best practices and adapt them in a way that will help you to be more impactful in your communities. And when you do that, please come back and share with us, Eli Lilly and Company, your successes and your failures in that effort. Now you might say, why would we do that? Well, because Lilly is a company that was built on discovery and caring. For discovery, it is critical to our ability to create new medications. In order for us to create new medications, which is essentially innovation, we need diverse people as employees at our company. And we need to be as successful as possible in encouraging those diverse people to unleash their creativity and curiosity to help us better serve the communities. Caring, it drives us to move further, to do everything we can to help patients. Caring is a critical ingredient to our success as a pharmaceutical company. It is also critical to our ability to constantly improve our customer service experience and to constantly be evolving into better business practices. You see, most of the people who work at Eli Lilly and Company, we came here primarily for one reason. Because we want to innovate and do all we can to help patients throughout the world. So with that in mind, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to discover new ways to help you be more effective when you return to your community. I want you to harness a caring spirit that will help you to do all you can to provide answers to those in your community. And on behalf of the almost 38,000 Eli Lilly and Company employees worldwide who come to work every day with the goal of improving the lives of people throughout the world and here in California, thank you.
Thank you so much, Delia and Monique, for those opening remarks. And now it is my pleasure to introduce to you our opening speaker, Dr. David Hayes Bautista, who is currently professor of medicine and director of the Center for the Study of Latino Health and Culture at the David School of Medicine at UCLA. He'll be talking to us about how our culture, which is really our strength, can be harnessed to improve our health.
Buenos días. Estamos en Los Ángeles. Buenos días. Muy bien, mejor. I'd like to, as a native Angeleno, I'd like to welcome you to my hometown, Los Angeles. And I want to talk this morning about some social determinants of health, but I want to go on beyond the standard SES, you know, the socioeconomic. I want to talk about a couple of other things. Now, let's just start off with our standard health minority disparity model. I took this right off the website of the Office of Research on Minority Health, and it says African American, American Indian, Alaska Native, Asian and Pacific Islander, and Hispanic citizens. Whew, man, I get tired just listing off all those people. Suffer poorer health and higher rates of premature death than the majority population. I'm sure you've heard of this before, right? So the question is, oh my God, minorities. Why are minorities always so sickly? Well, this is based on a classic model called the epidemiological risk factor model. If you're going to compare the health of two populations, and one population has higher risk factors, usually operationalized as lower income, lower education, less access to care, then that population is also going to have more bad health outcomes, more illness, more death, shorter life expectancy, more infant mortality. So these are often explained by the social determinants of health, income, education, access to care, and the zip code that you live in. Well, Latinos in the United States can reasonably be described as having the highest rate of risk factors, the lowest income of any group, the least education, the least access to care, and of course we live in the barrios. So I want to talk about a couple of additional determinants of health that we need to put into this mix. I want to talk about culture, and I want to talk about leadership as social determinants of health. Culture? Leadership? Where's this guy going? Okay, let's see. I'm a researcher at UCLA, and we use models to do research. And the whole point of doing our research is if we're doing good research and our model's good, our model should have predictive power. The models say that things are related in this way. You put something in, you're going to get something out pretty much all the time. So let's take a look at this model. Let's look at the top 10 causes of death in the United States for 2007. Number one cause of death is heart, followed by cancer, followed by stroke. They count for about 60% of all deaths. Now, let's look at the age-adjusted death rates for the number one cause of death, which is heart disease. Now, from the model, Latinos having far less income, education, and access to care compared to non-Hispanic whites. Who should have a higher heart disease rate? Should be Hispanic, no? So we look at the data for the United States, and it turns out, oops, can I go backwards? There we go. That the non-Hispanic white death rate is 187.8. The Hispanic is 136.0, 30% lower. Now, how do Latinos manage to have 30% fewer heart attacks? Is it the frijoles? Or maybe it's the tortillas? Okay, well, the whole point is we wouldn't expect this from the model, no? Okay, so let's look at the number two cause of death Here, the non-Hispanic white rate is 177.5. This is for the United States. The Latino rate is 116, 40% lower, all sites. Wow, maybe it is the beans. Number three, cause of death is stroke. Here, the Latino rate is only 20% lower. But you know that model that said that minorities should always have higher death rate? Once we put data to the model, it doesn't have predictive power that we want. In fact, we can start to answer this question. People worry, oh my God, what will the U.S. look like when one out of every three Americans is Latino? Well, if we look at the epidemiology of it, it actually looks pretty good. As we look at this Atlas of Stroke Mortality that was prepared by the Centers for Disease Control, they mapped out stroke across the country, not by ethnicity, but by county. And the way you read this map is the lighter shaded counties have the lower stroke death rate, and the darker the shading, the higher the stroke death rate. Now, if you happen to know in your mind where Latinos are a good part of the population, like Southern California, Arizona, New Mexico, Southwest Texas, Southeast Florida, Cook County, New York, New Jersey, you notice those counties are really light because Latinos have lower stroke death rates. And where you have fewer and fewer Latinos, like the Mississippi Valley, the Atlantic Seacoast, the stroke death rates are higher. So actually, as Latinos become a higher percent of the U.S. population, we help the U.S. become more healthy. And you can do the same exact mapping for heart disease. Now, when's the last time you ever heard that Latinos were good for the health of the United States? But look at the data, for please. Look at all causes of death. This is everything. And for all causes of death, the Latino rate is about 30% lower. Within that, there are two important exceptions, and they're the only ones you ever hear about, the exceptions, diabetes and homicide. Everything else were far, far lower. And interestingly, for something group like National Council of Race, you get people here, you know, Cubanos, Salvadoreños, Mexicanos, Puerto Ricanos, Dominicanos. We like to fight, you know, different groups. We're so different. But when we look at the epidemiology, Latino subgroups look more like one another than we look like anybody else. So here we have all causes of death. This is Mexican, Puerto Rican, Cuban. We vary around one another. We do not vary from the non-Hispanic white norm. We have our own norm in terms of epidemiology. Now let's look at the infant mortality paradox. We're going to focus in on California. 34 years of infant mortality. We're going to first look at non-Hispanic white. In 1970, it was about 14 deaths per 1,000 live births. Went down to about 5 deaths per 1,000 live births. Now we know from the birth certificate, Latina moms have less education. We know they receive fewer prenatal visits. We know that these are started later into the pregnancy. What is the effect of these risk factors on Latino infant mortality? For 34 years, it is identical to non-Hispanic white, even though the moms live worlds apart in terms of risk factor, income, education, access to care. What are Latinos doing? This has been called in the research world the Latino epidemiological paradox. And some people think, well, gee, the only way to be healthy is you use services more. So are Latinos using services more? I don't think so. Latinos actually, whether children, adolescents, or adults, make one fewer doctor visit per year, generate half the number of hospital bed days per 1,000. And for all of that, we have the longest life expectancy. Looking state by state, whether California, Florida, Illinois, New York, Texas, Latinos have anywhere from 3 to 5 year longer life expectancy compared to non-Hispanic white. So how about this for something to start with? Fewer heart attacks, fewer cancers, fewer strokes, healthy babies, longer life expectancies. But why are Latino babies so healthy? Well, let's look at some data. We're looking at risky moms. This is a study we did of teen births. And here's, we got all these data right from the birth certificate. So as we look at risk behaviors, smoking is a risky behavior. Well, it turns out that Latinas are about 90% less likely to smoke compared to non-Hispanic white teen moms. Less likely to smoke. If we look at acquiring a sexually transmitted disease during the pregnancy, Latinas are about 40% less likely to contract a sexually transmitted disease. And as we look at drug use, actually Latinas are about 2/3 less likely to give birth to a drug-exposed infant. So they're not smoking, they're not drinking, they're not using drugs, they're not doing, getting sexually transmitted disease, and they're not getting the prenatal care. Where did Latinas learn to acquire such healthy behavior? Who taught them, mija, when you're, well, I already gave it away, when you're pregnant, you don't drink, you don't smoke, okay? It was abuela. And this is culture, and we can see the effects in the outcomes, in the heart, in the cancer, the stroke, the infant mortality. This is culture. That's why I want us to consider culture as another social determinant of health. It's off the record. People don't want to look at it. They only look at income, education, and access to care. Those are horrible measures. But we have our culture we also bring into this, which can for a while combat that. But now we need to look at the challenges to this social determinant, and there are challenges. Let's go back to these pregnancy behaviors and outcomes. As we look at smoking, as we saw, Latinos are far less likely to smoke compared to non-Hispanic white. But if we disaggregate those Latinas into the U.S.-born and the immigrant, the U.S.-born are far more likely to smoke than the immigrants virtually don't smoke. 0.2% smoke. Now, granted, 1.1% is not a lot, but you notice the trend. The U.S.-born smoke more than the immigrants. As we look at sexually transmitted disease, again, Latinas had a lower rate compared to non-Hispanic white. But if we compare the U.S.-born to the immigrants, the U.S.-born have a higher percentage that have acquired a sexually transmitted disease. And then if we look at drug use, here we're looking at actually the first Hispanic Haines. These trends have continued. Whether male or female, I'll get these buttons right yet. Okay, whether male or female, immigrants have far lower drug use rate, and the U.S.-born have far higher drug use rates. And if we slice and dice this by language, this is really interesting. Latinos that speak only English here have the highest drug use rates. If they're bilingual, they drop considerably. If they speak primarily Spanish, virtually don't use drugs. This is not what you see on Fox Evening News, I hate to tell you. And we can see that in the outcomes that U.S.-born moms have about 20% higher rate of low birth weight babies compared to immigrant moms. And U.S.-born moms have about 20% higher infant mortality compared to immigrant moms. So culture is really important. And when that culture becomes eroded, wow, it doesn't look good for Latino health. So we need to understand culture as a social determinant of health. Now, I'd like to talk about leadership. Leadership, what does leadership have to do with health? Well, guess what, we're here at NCLR. We're all about leadership. Let's connect the dots. One of the biggest threats to health as we go off into the future is overweight, obesity, and of course, diabetes. There are all sorts, I'm sure you're having about 5 or 6 workshops here on diabetes and the problems caused by obesity. Well, it just so happens that Latino and African American kids have the dubious distinction of having the highest rates of obesity. Childhood obesity, of course, is rising in all groups. And what's alarming from a health and medical standpoint, remember type 2 diabetes, those of you who are old enough, we used to call it adult onset diabetes because you didn't see it until about age 40 or 50, it was adult onset. We're now seeing juvenile onset diabetes, children as young as 11, 12, 9, 8 showing up with type 2 diabetes, and it's directly related to obesity. Now, obesity in many ways is a very simple issue. Is simply a function of calories in, you know, how much do you eat and of what sort, and calories out. How do you get rid of those calories? How do you move out? That's pretty simple. And actually, I would say obesity should not be a problem because every 4-year-old kid has a built-in obesity-fighting program, which is if you have a 4-year-old child or niece or nephew or cousin, they don't sit still. They're always wiggling. They're always moving. You know, you can't hold them down. Haven't you seen parents that have these leashes on their kids because, you know, the kids are running around? It's wonderful. We should just let the kids move, and we could get a good handle on the obesity issue. But here's where we need to think of, where do they move? What about green space? The LA Times did an interesting story 2 years ago on obesity and in 2 cities. One city was Manhattan Beach. That's on the right on the beach. Manhattan Beach, only 4% of the kids were obese. Only 7% of the entire city is Latino. I mean, Latinos are pretty rare. Then they went inland about 20 miles to Walnut Park. That was 95% Latino, and 37% of the children there were obese. So some people looked at it pretty simplistically and said, gee, you don't have any Latinos, you don't have much obesity. You have a lot of Latinos, you got a lot of obesity. What are Latinos doing wrong? Well, is it something Latinos are doing wrong? Let's look at the issue of green space. In some research done by some colleagues of mine at UCLA, a child living in a predominantly non-Hispanic white area has access to 8,402 square feet of green space. That's about 2 city building lots. A child living in a predominantly Latino or African American neighborhood has access to 69 square feet. That's about 1 good closet. Okay. 69 square feet or 8,000 square feet of green space. Now, why are Latino children likely to be obese? Well, part of the reason is, where's the space for them to go? So there's a lack of green space to begin with. Or it's, here, I love this. I saw this up. Look, about 3x3 with a cut down tree. That's the green space. That was obviously a statement. But then we get more than that, because sometimes you have green space and it's a passive park. You can't use this. And there's a park over in Boyle Heights that merits the yellow card. Look at all this wonderful green space, and you can't run and play on it. And this poor father got a ticket because his kids were playing soccer on this green space. Well, you can't do that. It's passive. Then there's the issue, of course, a lot of immigrant families tend to live in apartment buildings. There's no green space there, but you do have corridors, you have parking lots, so kids love to run and jump and play down the corridors, down the steps, and so the landlords come in, no, you can't do this, and they prohibit kids from playing in their home, in the parking lot. So you can't play in the apartment grounds. You might have some green space. Usually you don't if you do it, and it may be passive. So why are Latino children overweight? And CDC just last year came out with this huge campaign to try to increase more green space. The CDC said, our children deserve more places to keep active. Our children need room to run, jump, and enjoy their childhood. Well, that sounds pretty simple, but Latino areas just don't have the kind of green space that other areas do. So, an overweight person goes to see the doctor. The doctor says, oh, you need to exercise. And this person's thinking, great, but there's no parks in my barrio. How am I gonna do that? So who can help the doctor? Well, remember how Chapulín always said, yo, right? Well, I want us to say, nosotros, right? Nosotros. Okay, we can help the doctor. Because who makes the decisions about green space? Well, this is a zoning issue. It's a planning issue. City councils, council people, planning commissions, zoning commissions, et cetera, they make the space. So who can educate the mayors and city councils and planning commissions about the need for green space? Nosotros, we can. Hello. And this is where leadership comes into play. We're seeing now, when Proposition passed here in California exactly 20 years ago, rather than rolling over, Latino leadership rose to the challenge, sued back, pushed back, and we have continued to do so. And here, NCLR is meeting right now. One of the focuses of the conference is on the migrant children at the border. And we do not turn our backs on those children. We need to assert our leadership and educate the political leadership about the situation and what needs to be done. So if it comes to keeping Latino children healthy, it's not enough just to have access to medical care. That's what the Affordable Care Act does. We need leadership to get involved so that these children, once they're feeling better, have a place to go out and run and jump and play. But I know some of you think, it's just me. But what can I do as an individual? Well, I want to just close by talking a little bit about Latino leadership in the United States. There are some elements of this country that most of us kind of take for granted, and we think this is what makes this country great. Everyone is a citizen regardless of racial background. Women have rights. You can live wherever you want. You can go to school where you want, and you can marry whomever you wish. Aren't those great rights that we have? Well, those rights are the result of Latino leadership in the United States. Latino leadership and those rights? I've never heard of this. Well, if you haven't, and this may be hard to remember, I want to give you a mnemonic to remember this, that Latino leadership has made this country what it is. And here's the mnemonic. El Cinco de Mayo. Okay, well, we all know Cinco de Mayo, right? It's probably the biggest holiday in the country. It's celebrated everywhere. But have any of you ever been in Mexico on a Cinco de Mayo? Okay, you go down there, and what happens in Mexico on Cinco de Mayo? Nothing. Only in Puebla, okay. And even in Puebla, it's only a 45-minute parade. Okay, and we start a week before, we go a week after, man, it's Semana de la Raza. Okay, so here is the mystery of the universe. Why do we celebrate Cinco de Mayo so much in the United States when it's not celebrated in Mexico? And what the heck does Latino leadership have to do with this? Well, I can give you a 30-second answer, because I know we have a session at 10 o'clock. So here's the 30-second answer. You want to time me? Okay. First, we need to understand Cinco de Mayo, then, is not a Mexican holiday. Because if it were, it'd be celebrated all over Mexico, and our Cinco de Mayo's here would just be little tiny imitations of what they do in Mexico. But instead, it's just the opposite. So if it's not a Mexican holiday, what is Cinco de Mayo? Well, it is an American Civil War holiday created by Latinos in the American West over the issues of the Civil War, race, color, citizenship, and slavery. Latinos in the American Civil War? I heard a lot of people say, "Ah, you guys just all arrived 30 years ago." No, we were here in the Civil War, and that's why this country is the way it is. And we and our leadership 150 years ago played a big role. Let's just go back. What do you mean, Latino leadership and these constitutional rights? Well, let's go back to another holiday we just finished celebrating. 4th of July, 1776. Declaration of Independence had some great ideals in it. All men are created equal and created with certain inalienable rights, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Hey, I can buy that. That's pretty good. They fight the war. They get their independence. They sit down to write their constitution. And somebody pulls out the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. Does that mean we have to release the slaves? Oh, no, we didn't mean that. Well, didn't you just say all men are created equal? Well, only all white men are created equal. If you're not white, you're not created equal, and you don't get life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, so we can write a constitution and have slavery and say, hey, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. And the non-white groups they're most familiar with are African Americans and American Indians. Well, in the rest of the American hemisphere, there was a different history going on of what I call Indo, Afro, Oriento, Ibero, America, as Indians, Africans, Asians, and Europeans had been mixing and meeting and matching for 500 years. And we are a mestizo population. We're kind of all of the above. This is why we give the Census Bureau nuts when they ask us, what race are you? Well, I'm kind of all of the above, but I don't see all of the above. During colonial Spain, in fact, these were called the castas. They had a 16-way table to categorize what percentage of Indian, African, Asian, or European you were. And, of course, only the all-whites got all the goodies. So this is what was happening in Indo, Afro, Oriento, Ibero, America. And when I look out here, I can see Indo, Afro, Oriento, Ibero, America in your faces. Well, when Hidalgo declared independence in 1810, he was very clear about why they wanted to be independent. He said, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to abolish slavery. How can we have a republic and call us and still have slavery? I mean, that doesn't go. In fact, he was going to give the masters 10 days to free their slaves, or he was going to put the masters in jail. And he said, we're going to get rid of this ley de castas. Everyone will be a citizen of the Republic of Mexico, irrespective of racial origin, period. In fact, here's Jose Maria Morelos' announcement 2 months later, the first announcement of the new government of Mexico. He said, I publicly announce the establishment of the new government that will not label anyone as Indian, mulatto, or any casta, but rather all will be known generally as Americans. Not Mexicans, Americanos. Somos Americanos todos, no? Sí, okay, hey, they knew it. Somos Americanos. And they continued the Spanish legal tradition of legal protection of the economic goods of married women. And Mexico wasn't alone. Every single Latin American republic, upon achieving independence from Spain, abolished slavery and opened citizenship to everyone, irrespective of racial background, and continued legal rights for married women. Well, guess what? Here in the American West, particularly in California, we were part of Mexico. This was the law of the land here. This was the Constitution. No slavery, racial equality, women's rights. Then came the Big Bang, 1848. The United States arrived. And the U.S. Constitution permitted slavery, denied citizenship to non-whites, and the concept of legal rights for married women didn't even exist. I mean, the woman suffered, it was called legal death when she married, lost everything. Everything belonged to the husband. California is going to write its Constitution in 1849. Were Latinos going to let this just be the law? No. Latino leadership stepped up in 1849. The children of the grandchildren of the pobladores, the Indians, the Africans, the Asians, and Europeans, all their mestizo glory, showed up at the Constitutional Convention. And the first thing they said is, by the way, we've been speaking Spanish here for a century. We're going to write the Constitución del Estado de California. And they also wrote a version in English, the California State Constitution. But the Constitution very explicitly said, all laws, decrees, regulations, and provision, which from their nature require publication, shall be published in English and Spanish. Spanish is not a foreign language in California. It never has been. But there are those who think it is, so we need to give them some constitutional history. Then the issue of slavery arose. Would California be a slave state or a free state? The Latinos said, nope, we have not had slavery in this state since 1810. We're not going to have slavery now. California came in as a free state. That upset the balance of the Missouri Compromise. It actually led to the Civil War. And, of course, the folks from the East Coast said, well, of course, only white people are going to be citizens, right? And the Latinos said, are you kidding? We've been running the state for a couple of generations, and non-whites were allowed to be citizens in the California Constitution. This is Governor Pio Pico. He was the last Mexican governor of California. If you just go up to La Plaza, there's the Pico House. He built that in 1874. I mean, you look at that photograph, clearly he's of African and Indian ancestry. He was a citizen of California, and he voted in every single election until his death in 1894. In Alabama, he was considered property, and he would have been working out on a plantation. And, of course, women's rights were also continued in the new Constitution. So here we have a notice taken out in Los Angeles in 1858 by Ramona Barelas, who says, she is the wife of Jose Maria Martinez, and she declares that she intends to do business in her own name and on her own account because she was a Latina here in California. This is the legal precedent for women's rights. Well, these issues of slavery, citizenship, color, race tore this country apart, and it was plunged into civil war. Well, Latinos knew all about the Civil War. They were reading, they knew all the issues. For example, when that first encounter of armored ships took place, the Monitor and the Merrimack, Latinos out here were reading about El Monitor y la Merrimack. They knew every detail of that battle. When the Emancipation Proclamation was the law of the land, Latinos read it in Spanish, and they cheered, and then they booed. They booed because they said, Lincoln, that's a great step, but you only freed slaves in the rebelling states. You didn't free them in the northern states. Why don't you emancipate all slaves? And finally, he did. And the question arose, which side in this great war would Latinos support? Well, for Latinos, it's kind of a no-brainer. What was the Confederacy fighting for? To maintain slavery, to maintain white supremacy, racial inequality, to maintain elite rule. Latinos had come from a Latin American tradition of no slavery, racial equality, women's rights, pure democracy. And they said, hey, we're going to support the North. We're supporting Lincoln and the Union. Not only with words, they joined the armed forces. This is Major Jose Ramon Pico. By the way, there's Pico Boulevard right here. Them Picos, okay. He organized units of Spanish-speaking United States cavalry, and they rode off to war. Here's our artist's rendition of it. You had Spanish-speaking U.S. cavalry operating out of New Mexico under Major Rafael Chacon. You had Spanish-speaking cavalry operating under General Cortina of the Cortina Wars. He was for the Union during the Civil War. The first admiral of the United States Navy was David Farragut, a bilingual, bicultural Latino. If you go to Washington, there's a stop. You may have heard of it. Farragut, they pronounce it. Farragut, it's a Catalan name. His father was a Catalan. And so they bet the ranch on the North, but guess what? Here is where the Confederates found an ally, Napoleon III, the Emperor of the French, who loved the Confederates, and he wanted to help the Confederates. So he sent his armies into Mexico so he could put an emperor in who would then sympathize with the Confederates. Well, as the army was marching on to Mexico City, Latinos up here realized, okay, we've been fighting, we've been supporting the United States against the Confederates. Now we need to support Mexico against the French because the French and the Confederates are very, very sympathetic to one another. And, of course, we all know what happened. The French thought they were going to have an easy trek into Mexico City. They got stopped at the Battle of Puebla. This is the headlines here, read in California and Los Angeles. Viva Mexico! Viva Zaragoza! The French did not make it to Mexico City. Mexico remained a republic. The Confederates did not have an ally. And it was the first major victory for the forces of freedom and democracy ever since the Confederate guns had fired on Fort Sumter. And there were spontaneous celebrations of this victory by Latinos here because it meant the Civil War is not over. We can hold on. And there were celebrations all during the Civil War, all around the American West. Here's the Cinco de Mayo in Los Angeles. Here's the Cinco de Mayo up in Camp Calaveritas, up in Calaveras County. Here's Cinco de Mayo in Stockton. Here is Cinco de Mayo in San Francisco. Here is Cinco de Mayo in the mining town of Hornitos up in Mariposa County. Here is Cinco de Mayo in San Andreas up in Amador County. Cinco de Mayo in Sutter Creek up in Amador County. Cinco de Mayo in Nevada in Virginia City. Cinco de Mayo in the mine of New Almaden just south of San Jose. Cinco de Mayo in Los Angeles. This is why they began celebrating. It was a public statement of where Latinos stood on the issues of the Civil War. We opposed slavery. We support freedom. We opposed white supremacy. We support racial equality. We opposed elitist rule. We support democracy. This is why they began Cinco de Mayo. They took leadership on these issues. And in fact, now military historians are beginning to understand that the Battle of Puebla saved the United States because if the French had arrived in early in 1862, they would have joined up with the Confederates, and you wouldn't even have had a Battle of Gettysburg. We gave the United States the breathing room it needed, gave Lincoln the time it took to find a general who could win wars. If it weren't for the Battle of Puebla, we probably wouldn't be talking about the United States as we know it. And let's look at this. When Lincoln had to run for re-election in 1864, and it wasn't clear that he was going to win because the Civil War was still going badly, Latinos would not let this stand. This poster, Candidatos del Partido de la Unión para Presidente Abraham Lincoln. And look at the flags that illustrate this, the Mexican flag and the United States flag, because those are the flags of freedom and democracy. Well, finally, Lincoln won the election, the Confederates finally surrendered, the French finally surrendered, and liberty and democracy won. And interestingly, the United States Constitution began to Latinize itself. It began to look like all the other constitutions of Latin America. The 13th Amendment got rid of slavery. The 14th Amendment allowed all races to become citizens. And they're still working on women's rights. They got a bit more, but you know, eventually they'll get to where all the rest of Latin America is on this. Latino leadership has always improved the United States, be it in civil rights, be it in health. This is why I say leadership is so important. So let's add to these social determinants of health, income, education, access to care, culture, leadership. Latino culture and leadership for a better, healthier America. That is what we have to offer. That's why we're having this conference this weekend. And to remember all of this, just think, Viva el Cinco de Mayo. Thank you very much. We have a couple minutes, time for Q&A or just feelings. How are you feeling right now? You got a big smile on your face. No, lady in the orange blouse. Why are you smiling? You didn't know all of this. How do you feel now that you know it? Awesome. Oh, okay. Yes, lady in the green. Yes.
Mm-hmm. How? There we go.
Okay.
Should I repeat what I was saying?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I wanted to ask a little bit about what you were talking about, the protective role of culture for Latina women in pregnancy and their and birth outcomes. And I was just wondering, how would you explain the deep disparities that Puerto Rican women face? Because they are an outlier compared to other Latinas in terms of high level of infant mortality and complications and preterm labor and underweight babies.
I think here's where we need to show some leadership. This whole issue of these Latino epidemiological paradox is news to a lot of people. And I keep thinking, we've run the numbers, if everyone in the United States had the same profile as Latinos for heart cancer and stroke, we would save close to 300,000 lives every single year. And you wouldn't need to reform healthcare again. You wouldn't need new hospital chains. What is it that Latinos are doing? And I'm thinking that should be number one on the list of every medical school dean's list of things I got to do today. What explains the Latino epidemiological paradox? Every medical school should have their top flight team of researchers working on this, and they don't. It's a surprise to them. What? Latinos can do something right? I didn't know that. We don't know the mechanism. So I can't explain why would Puerto Rican women be an outlier, but as part of it, we don't even understand the bigger thing to understand then the variations, the exceptions to the rule, because we just haven't done the research. This country has seen not fit not to invest in it, not to develop the researchers. I mean, you know of a medical school that's devoting a research center to this? No. There are a few of us researchers. We have to fight our way, and, you know, NIH rarely funds this sort of stuff. So, unfortunately, we can't explain the big picture, so how can we explain the exceptions? I don't know. But I think we need to find out, because this truly would be health reform if we could understand the Latino epidemiological paradox. It'd be good for everybody. We need to do the research.
Professor?
That's a plug. Lady in the orange dress. Yes, yes, you. With a scarf. I think it's orange, isn't that orange?
Is it on?
Yes, I was very surprised when you had the map of the date when all the different American countries obtained their
Mm-hmm. It's not there? I'll put it in for sure.
Yes, it was the first republic in America.
Okay, we'll complete it. We'll complete it.
Professor?
Let's see.
Right here.
Lady in the back.
Right
and
here.
Then, okay, the gentleman, I guess he's got the microphone. Yes.
I got the microphone, so I cut in front. Sorry. On the topic of green space and exercise for children, I think one thing that needs to be emphasized, David Vliet, Tiburcio Vasquez Health Center, is that I think there needs to be a conscious effort around greater clinical nutrition integration, starting with pediatrics, so that there is discussion with parents about, obviously, nutrition, health choices, eliminating sweet drinks, reducing carbohydrates and the kinds of foods that children are eating. But that clinical dietetics, I don't think, has been integrated into primary care in the way that it does. We use clinical dietetics with babies that, you know, have failure to thrive. But what about that consistent education for both parent and child, mm-hmm. managing weight from the very beginning, teaching nutrition in a way, obviously, that will produce outcomes that, result in less obesity? I think the green space argument is definitely pertinent around issues of safety. But I see a lot of kids, unfortunately, in the grocery store, parents going down aisles loaded with, you know, just terrible food produced by companies who have no interest in our nutrition. It's all about the dollar. Lots of wheat, lots of sugar. I think that this is an approach from a clinical standpoint that could address some of this.
Well, as you're talking about the choices available, et cetera, again, that's where leadership can make a difference. We see it, for example, in some school districts that banned the junk foods and their vending machines. That took leadership. These seem like small steps, but they're very important steps. So yes, we need to tie it together, but we need leadership to move the needle. Now there is a lady, yes, in the back. I'm glad you mentioned that. Could you talk about the video recording? This is being recorded, right? There's a question, could they access this? That's it. Okay. All right.
Okay. Sorry. Unfortunately, that has to be our last question. So in terms of the video, it is being recorded. It will be up on our website next week as my colleague that's doing this is going on vacation the rest of this week, so I want to let him rest. But it will be available on our website on the Health Summit agenda page. So please keep an eye out for it. Thank you so much, Dr. Hayes Bautista. Great speaker. Can we give him a round of applause? Great breakfast, great speakers. Thank you all for joining us. Few quick housekeeping things, and then we'll let you go. We have just a little over 10 minutes until the next session starts. They will all be on your right-hand side or around the corner, depending on the session. On your right-hand side are also the bathrooms. And in the first three rows of each session room are going to be some white index cards. So those are there for you to think of any questions for our Health Town Hall panelists. And the Health Town Hall topic this year is going to focus on those who will remain uninsured despite ACA implementation. So think about those and write them down on the index card, and then you're going to go ahead and hand those to your monitors for that session, one of which will be me. I'll be in the promotores panel, and my colleague Alejandra Jepp is monitoring the childhood obesity panel. Yes, the next panel. So just please go ahead and provide it to your monitor. Also, just a friendly reminder that, again, my colleague Liz will be walking around so we can head to the next session. So when you hear this, did it go off? Sorry. That's a sign that we're about to start, and to please take your seat. So thank you so much, everyone.